Hello everyone and welcome to this session of Geometry and Tacos. My name is Erika Mazzon and my talk will be about dual complexes in birational and non-Archimedean geometry. So my first goal will be to introduce the notion of dual complex, and then we will see how these interact with the techniques of birational geometry, and then also how we can rephrase and talk about dual complex in non-Archimedean geometry. So, but let's start first of all by giving you the definition of the dual complex that I will consider today. So when we consider a straight normal crossing variety that I denote by S and C, so this is a variety that in general is not irreducible, so it has many reducible components, but these components are smooth and they intersect transversely. Here you see three examples. Then to such a variety, we can associate a topological object, topological space that is triangulated, meaning that it's constructed by gluing simplices in the following way. So for each reducible component yi, we consider a zero cells, so a zero dimensional simplex. If two components yi and yj, they intersect non-trivially, then we will have a one cell joining vi and vj. And in particular, we do not assume that this intersection is irreducible, so it can have many reducible components. So we will remember these different irreducible components by adding more than one cell joining Vi and Vj. Then we can keep doing this also for higher codimension intersection. So suppose that we have Yi0 and Yik meeting not trivially, then we will have a K cell joining Vi0, Vik. So for instance, in these three examples that I picture, let's also associate the dual complex. So in the first example, we only have two reducible components. So we'll have two zero cells. And then we have intersection of these two components as two irreducible components. So it means two edges joining at the two vertices. Then the other two examples are, higher dimensional. For instance, we've seen three components and three vertices. Two components meets along a line, so three edges. And then in particular, we have a point where three of them intersect. So these give rise to two cells filling this triangle. So in general, this is a general construction. Let me mention two contexts coming from algebraic geometry where dual complex can naturally be constructed. So the first context is the context of the isolated singularity. So suppose that we have a variety X and we fix a point such that this point is singular. Then by resolution of singularity, we can construct a morphism F such that now the variety Y will be smooth and the fiber of our singular point is indeed straight normal crossing. So then to this exceptional locus of F, we can associate a dual complex. And what Stepanov proof is that indeed the homotopy type of the dual complex is independent on the choice of a resolution. So it means that the dual complex can change, but at least the homotopy type is preserved. Then it's a construction by Collard. They show that indeed all the finite simplicial complex occur as dual complex associated to an isolated singularity. So all the possible simplicial complex that you can think of, you can also construct an isolated singularity that will realize such dual complex. So then the question becomes, if all the dual complex can be realized, can we relate the algebraic property of the singularity to the topology of the dual complex? Is there like a relation, a reflection, some constraint between the type of singularities and the topology? So these questions have been investigated. Let me mention just two results about this relation. So here you have, for instance, if we work with rational singularity, then one can easily prove that the dual complex will be quasi-cyclic, meaning a condition on the rational cohomology. But what Kapovich, Collard, and Collard prove is that a dual complex occur as the dual complex of a rational singularity if and only if this dual complex is quasi-cyclic. So this is a sort of inverse implication of the previous one. Then it is a result by the Fernet collaring zoo, is that if we start singularity that are denoted KLT, Kawamata log terminal, these are singularity that are encoded in rational geometry using the minimal model program. Then what they prove is that a KLT singularity as a dual complex associated to it as a contractible dual complex. So here again, we see how the singularity and the type of singularity constrained the dual complex. Then a second context where we can naturally construct dual complexes is when we consider degeneration of varieties. So suppose that we have a family of variety over a curve C. Suppose that this family is a smooth family. So all the fiber are also smooth except the fiber over a fixed point, like over the origin zero. Then this fiber curly X naught is supposed to be a straight normal crossing. So, I mean, we usually call this degeneration, or even like I will also call them model for the generic fiber of the family. Then, since we assume this degenerate fiber, this central fiber to be SNC, we will have again a dual complex associated to it. And once again, we can start to ask how is the topology of this dual complex in relation with, for instance, the geometry of the generic fiber. So one first thing that can be observed is that, for instance, if we look at the rational cohomology of the dual complex, these encode some part of the odd structure, first of all, of the degenerate fiber, but even of our variety X, because it encodes the weight zero pieces of the limited structure of our variety X. So this observation can be, for instance, used in the work by Collard, Laza, Sakai, and Voisin, where they consider some specific type of degeneration, the one for strict Calabi-Yau or hyperkähler. And I mean, among the many results that they have, for instance, they have that if we fix a maximally degenerate degeneration, meaning that if n is the dimension of our variety, we are assuming also the dual complex to be of dimension n. So this is the maximum dimension that the dual complex can have. Then what they prove is that indeed this sequence of isomorphism can be like pushed further, such that now this weight zero piece of the limited structure will be isomorphic to the k zero piece of the cohomology of the generic fiber. So if we read everything together, here we're seeing a relation between the cohomology of X and the cohomology of the dual complex. So in particular, in the odd diamond of our generic fiber X, this is the part we are looking at. And what we're saying is that the geometry of X, in particular, this part of its odd structure, indeed constrained the cohomology, the rational cohomology of the dual complex. Since in particular, we are working with strict Calabi-Yau and hyperkähler manifold, we know this part. And so what we can conclude is that the dual complex has the rational homology of a sphere, in the first case, strict Calabi-Yau, of a projective space if we're working with hyperkähler manifold. So here we will see an instance where the geometry of X constrained the topology of the dual complex. So we can also try to use this connection the other way around. So try to use properties as a result on the topology of the dual complex to get information about the generic fiber or like more classical algebraic objects. And so this, for instance, has been used in the work by Oybret and Xu, where they study Lagrangian fibration of hyperkähler fourfolds, and they want to study the base of this fibration. So they use like result on the side of the dual complex to claim that in the end, this base has to be smooth. So in particular, has to be a projective space of dimension two, so CP2. So, I mean, this is the context where we will work most of my talk. So it will be the context of degeneration of varieties. And in particular, since we want to see the interaction between dual complex and birational geometry, We would like to see what happens to the dual complex when we consider some birational transformation. I mean, how this will change along with a birational transformation. So the first birational transformation that we will look at are indeed blow-ups. So suppose that we start with an S&C pair, such that our divisor is S&C and in particular is reduced. So all the coefficients are equal to one. And let's consider a blow-up. So here it's curly Y will be the blow-up. And we suppose that we are blowing up a locus that is still strict normal crossing with our fixed divisor. Then the new divisor that we look at in curly Y will be given by the strict transform of the original divisor delta curly X plus the exceptional divisor. Then this situation has been studied by Stepanov, where he studied how the dual complex will indeed change. And he distinguished based two cases. The first case is when we consider the blow-up of a stratum. So the locus Z is really given equal to the intersection of sum of components. Here, for instance, in intersection of three in this picture, or here it's in intersection of two components. Then at the level of dual complex, the dual complex of delta curly Y will only change inducing a star subdivision of the original dual complex. So meaning that the underlying topological space is exactly the same. The only difference is the simplicial structure that we're looking at. So the decomposition, we're only refining some simplices. And in particular, we refine the simplex corresponding to the stratum we're blowing up. So here, if we're blowing up this stratum, then the corresponding simplex is the triangle. So we consider a star subdivision of the triangle. In this other case, we have an edge. So we consider the star subdivision of the edge. So this is what happened in the first case for blow-up of strata. Now let's look at the second case. So let's assume that now we blow up a locus Z that is not a stratum. So it will be contained in a component or an intersection of component, but it does not coincide with such an intersection. Then in this case, what Stepanov described is the changing of the dual complex. For instance, in these two examples that I illustrated here, will give rise in one case to a new two-dimensional cell attached to the dual complex, or in the second case, just to a one cells attached to the original dual complex. In both cases, in the case of both of a stratum or Z not a stratum, what Stepanov proved is that in general, the two dual complex have the same homotopy type such that one can be collapsed to the other. So it does not really prescribe, how we should collapse this face onto this edge, but it proved that indeed it exists such a collapse. So we can collapse in this way, or maybe, we can choose, it's just an existing result that we can collapse back such that all these dual complexes will have the same homotopy type. Now, it is natural to ask, here we just look at S&C pair. So let's suppose that, even if we were with S&C degeneration, we've seen that the dual complex really depends on the particular S&C pair that we look at, even if the homotopy type is preserved. But a natural question will be if it's possible within this homotopy class to find a distinguished homeomorphism type. So, I could rephrase this question saying, instead of looking at all the S&C degeneration, and we've seen that, like in this example, we could always blow up, find another S&C degeneration, and then the dual complex, will have a different homeomorphism type. Is it possible to find like a canonical class of degeneration such that then the associated dual complex will have a well-defined homeomorphism type? So this question has been investigated, and the right answer has been identified in the work of De Ferney, Collard, and Xu, and it is related to the notion of minimality in the minimal model program. So for this reason, let me just let me move to some relation between dual complex and MMP. So we've seen that the goal of the MMP is to decompose an algebraic variety using birational transformation into three main building blocks. These three main building blocks, this trichotomy, it coincides with a property of the canonical line bundle. So we have the first main building block are the Fano varieties, where minus kx is ample. Then we have the Calabiau varieties, where the canonical line bundle is trivial. And then we have the canonically polarized, where the canonical line bundle is ample. Now, let's try to see some properties, some properties of the dual complex with respect, for instance, the Fano varieties. So when we have Fano varieties, we can consider any SNC degeneration. And what the Fernet, Collard, and Xu prove is that then the dual complex is contractible. So then if you imagine that a variety to have these main building blocks composed and mixed together, and we expect the dual complex also sort of to reflect this decomposition, then the part that will come from a Fano variety will give rise to a dual complex that is contractible. So in some sense, topologically, will not be like the interesting part of the final dual complex of our variety. So let's focus on the other case. And so, here I distinguish the case Calabiau and canonically polarized as sort of end products of the MMP, so main building blocks. But let me just treat them all together by assuming that we work with a variety X such that Kx is semi-ample. So both the Calabiau and the canonically polarized satisfy this condition. So then the goal what we would like to achieve is that we want to start with a variety X that is semi-ample. We want to consider an SNC degeneration. Let's denote it curly X, the degeneration, and curly X not the special fiber. So we are working always over a curve. So this is a relative MMP. And what we would like to do is we would like to consider an MMP. Then we want to study the end product of this MMP. And in particular, we want to see if we can associate a dual complex and how can we relate this dual complex of curly Y naught to curly X naught. Okay. So the first thing that we need to guarantee is that after we run an MMP, we can still talk about a dual complex. So here we start with an SNC pair, but SNC pair are not preserved in the MMP because we know that while we are doing the transformation of the MMP, we need to allow some mild singularities. And in particular, we cannot guarantee that an SNC pair will be preserved. So we'll keep being SNC. But what is preserved are the DLT pairs. So these are resolved by Collard-Mori. The DLT pairs are stable under MMP. So what are DLT? So DLT stands for divisorial log terminal. It's not really important now in this moment, the definition, but first you can think of this as a generalization of SNC, such that indeed SNC are DLT. So in particular, we start with an SNC degeneration and we run an MMP. We end up with a DLT pair. So this is the first way we use this result. And the second one is that you need to think of DLT as indeed a generalization of SNC in the sense that if we look at our divisor and we look at intersection of the component and we look at them at the generic point, then at the generic point, our pair is still SNC. So we can just ignore the singularity since they will be away from the generic point of the strata and associate a dual complex in the same way as we were doing for SNC pair. So this means that in particular, a DLT pair has a well-defined dual complex associated to it. So we are fine. And then let me mention that since here we're working with an MMP, so our end product will indeed have the property of the end product of an MMP. So for instance, we have some positivity property. Here is stated that k curly y plus y naught is relative in F. But since we are starting with something that is semi-ample, we can even achieve something better. So we can assume this line bundle to be semi-ample. So such a variety will be called for me from now on a minimal DLT degeneration, DLT for the kind of singularity we're working with, minimal because it's minimal in the sense of the MMP. And then the adjective good is given if we want to stress the fact that we are in the semi-ample case. Okay. So now, De Ferney, Collard, and Xu proved that at each step of the MMP, when we do this transformation, the dual complex changing just by a collapse. So a similar result to the one of Stepanov for dual complex. And this implies that then the dual complex, the original one, and the one associated to curly Y, they have the same homotopy type. So at least we know that we are not changing the homotopy class while performing an MMP. Then combining the result by Collard-Mori and De Ferney, Collard, and Xu, we can even prove something more, meaning that the PL, so piecewise linear homomorphism type of the dual complex is indeed independent on the choice of minimal DLT degeneration. So we know that, I mean, this minimal DLT is not unique. It can be achieved by running an MMP. But what this result is saying is that the associated dual complex is indeed well-defined as a homomorphism type. So this is proved in two steps. First, we need to prove that two minimal DLT degeneration are Crepin birational. This is proving Collard-Mori. And then De Ferney, Collard, and Xu prove that if we have a minimal DLT, variety that are Crepin birational, then they also give rise to the same dual complex in terms of its homeomorphism type. So now that we have found like the right notion, it is this good minimal degeneration to associate a canonical dual complex as homeomorphism type, we could try to rephrase the question we were wondering about how to relate the geometry of X to the topology of our dual complex in terms of this specific dual complex that we found, the one associated to a minimal DLT degeneration. So, I mean, one of the questions that, I mean, are now open in arbitrary dimension is, for instance, if we start with a street normal, a street Calabiao that is simply connected of dimension n, then we've already seen that the dual complex has the rational homology of a sphere. But then the question is this dual complex PL homomorphic to a sphere? So now the question makes sense because this has a well-defined homomorphism type. And so we can wonder if it's indeed an n-dimensional sphere. So right now we have answer in the case n equal two by Kulikov. We have answer by Collard and Xu when n is equal three. In the case where n is equal four, and the special fiber of this DLT degeneration, we assume to be a straight normal crossing divisor. Then in arbitrary dimension, the best that has been proved so far is that indeed this dual complex is a simply connected rational homology sphere. But but we're still missing the proof that this is indeed PL homomorphic to a sphere of dimension n. So, I mean, what we've done so far, let me just wrap up, is we introduced the dual complex. We've seen the dual complex in relation with some birational transformation, in particular with blow-ups, with running an MMP. And we've seen that the MMP, with its notion of minimal DLT degeneration, give us the right notion of minimality that is needed to distinguish an homomorphism type within the class of the homotopy type of SNC degeneration. Okay, so now what I would like to present now is the evaluative interpretation of dual complex. So the aim is to see, I mean, these dual complex now are just absurd topological object given by gluing symplices. Now we would like to realize them inside an ambient space that is a non-Archimedean space. And in particular, we would like to see in which sense this embedding, I mean, this point of view, this non-Archimedean point of view, can be convenient in some situation. So let's move to dual complex in non-Archimedean geometry. So we are working in a similar setting. So we still have a family of variety over a curve, a puncture curve, in the sense that, I mean, we fix a zero element here, and we have our generic fiber and our SNC variety over zero. Then, since we want to work in a slightly more algebraic setting, let's just focus our attention in a formal neighborhood of the origin. So let's just consider the formal completion of our curve at zero. So this is now isomorphic to C double bracket T, such that now our family becomes a family over this formal neighborhood, C double bracket T, that you need to think as a small disk centered at zero, algebraic disk. And our variety is now defined over the punctured disk, because, I mean, where indeed T is invertible, so away from zero. In such a setting, when we have such a variety X over C double bracket T, we can associate a topological object called the Berkovich space. So this is a topological space whose points are valuation. So let me recall what we mean by valuation. So most of the points in our Berkovich space will be valuation on the function field of our variety. So these are real valued function from the function field to R that satisfy three conditions. So firstly, we consider the valuation of A times B, then this is the sum of VA plus VB. If you consider the valuation of A plus B, then this is at least the minimum between VA and VB. And in particular, we restrict the valuation to our base field C double bracket T, then this coincides with the order of vanishing along T. So let me recall how this is defined. So every element in C double bracket T is a series. We can consider the smallest n zero such that A n zero is different from zero. Then the order of vanishing along T will be indeed this index n zero. Okay. So we have introduced Berkovich space in order to have an ambient space such that the dual complex will now be embedded inside the Berkovich space. So what I need to show you is how, for instance, to such a variety curly X that we assume to be an SNC degeneration of X, we can consider the dual complex, this part we already know. So let me assume, so we have an SNC divisor, we have the dual complex. Now what we want to see is how this dual complex sits inside the Berkovich space. So this boils down to giving evaluative interpretation to all the points of the dual complex. So let's start with the vertices. If I have a vertex V1, then this comes from a divisor D1. I mean, just by the construction of the simplex. So the idea is that then to the vertex V1, I will associate a valuation VD1, that is the order of vanishing along the component D1. So to be precise, here is what we define this valuation. So locally, D1 is defined by the vanishing of a function F1. Then any other function in the function field of our variety can be written as F1 times A, at power A times H, where H is not divisible by F1. Then the order of vanishing along D1 of F is indeed this power A. So this gives this gives a way to embed all the vertices inside the Berkovich space, because all the vertices will have a divisorial, a divisor associated. And so we can construct this divisorial valuation VD1 or VDI in general. Then the idea for a point that is not a vertex, but is for instance in the interior of a simplex, is that the valuation V will be constructing. So if V lies in the cells defined by V1 and V2, then the valuation is constructing, interpolating the divisorial valuation VD1 and VD2. Okay, so the upshot is that in the end, we get a canonical embedding of the dual complex inside the Berkovich space. And this embedded image is now called a skeleton. So we've seen here that what also the notation is suggesting, that as the dual complex really depends on the spatial fiber that we consider, also the skeleton depends on the model. So even if we are keeping the generic fiber fixed, so this is our X that is fixed, the model curly X then will only vary in the spatial fiber, but the skeleton indeed, I mean, we really depend on the model we are considering. Okay, so here is what we have so far. So we fix a variety that is most projective. We've seen that we can construct a Berkovich space associated to it. And in particular, for any SNC degeneration, we will have an embedding of the dual complex inside the Berkovich space, and this will be called a skeleton. Then what is interesting in this setting is that we also have a retraction. So we not only have an embedding of the dual complex as a skeleton, but we can also retract the whole Berkovich space onto the skeleton of curly X. So let me give you an idea of how this retraction is defined. So suppose that we fix a valuation V, we want to study the retraction. Then the first thing the first ingredient is that since we're working with projective variety, then we can use evaluative criteria of properness. So the valuation V will have an associated center called C curly X of V that is a point in the spatial fiber. So this point in the spatial fiber will in particular be contained in a smallest stratum. So there will be a smallest intersection of component containing this center. So this gives us a way to indeed identify one simplex inside the dual complex, so inside the skeleton, associated to the center, hence associated to V. Now the game is that, okay, we know basically that our V has to be sent inside this simplex. We can parameterize this simplex using barycentric coordinate, but we need to understand, okay, which point in this simplex will be the image of V. So the way to construct a map that sends V to a point in this simplex is by looking at the local equation of the component defining that stratum at the points at the center. And then the barycentric coordinate will be given by evaluating the valuation V on this local equation. So this will give us a well-defined way to identify the image of our retraction. But about this retraction, I mean, we can prove also further interesting properties. And one in particular that I want to mention is the property proved by Berkovich and Toulier. They proved that indeed this retraction is not just a retraction onto the skeleton, but is a strong deformation retraction, which implies that the whole Berkovich space and the skeleton have the same homotopy type. Okay, so this is another alternative proof of the fact that dual complexes of SNC degeneration have the same homotopy type, because each of these dual complexes homeomorphic to the skeleton, and all the skeleton have the same homotopy type of one fixed topological space, that is the Berkovich space. So here we found like another alternative way to prove this statement. And if you remember, I mean, this homotopy properties was already observed when we mentioned the result by Stepanov. So in this direction, let me make one remark. So suppose that now we consider two SNC models, curly X prime and curly X, one dominating the other. If you want to have an example in mind, you can think of this as the blow up of a locus inside the spatial fiber of curly X, as in the setting by Stepanov. Then our retraction is in general defined from the old Berkovich space to the skeleton. But we can just consider his restriction to the skeleton of curly X prime. So what this map is giving us is a map from a dual complex of the spatial fiber of X prime to the dual complex of the spatial fiber of X. But now, I mean, for instance, if you remember the case of dual of blowups, for instance, this will give us a map from this dual complex back to this dual complex. But the difference between this retraction and the collapses we've seen in Stepanov is that, I mean, in Stepanov, the collapses are not really prescribed. I mean, we only know that it is possible to retract this yellow simplex back to this edge. While here in the Berkovich setting, we are sort of also describing how this retraction works. Indeed, in this case, we will have that the vertex VE has to retract to the vertex V1. So in some sense, we have more geometric realization of these abstract collapses. Okay. And then let me finish by adding a third property of these retractions. So thanks to this retraction rho curl X, we can prove, I mean, this is a result by Berkovich, that the old Berkovich space is homeomorphic to the inverse limit of all these skeletons. And here the map is constructing, the homomorphism is constructing using this map rho X. So here you see why we are particularly interested in dual complexes, also in the context of non-Archimedean geometry. Because if we have a dual complex, we have a skeleton. So in particular, we have a topological object that encodes the same homotopy type, so the same homotopy information of the old Berkovich space. And also the second reason why we're particularly interested in dual complexes is that if we let the model vary, so we have all these maps, so we have a skeleton that is bigger and bigger, but these are all dual complexes that becomes bigger and bigger, then in the limit, we have the old, a description of the old Berkovich space. Meaning that any point in Berkovich space is completely determined by all its approximation, all its retraction to the various skeletons. Okay. So if we want to have like a picture image of this homomorphism, let's look at one example. It is the example of an elliptic curve. So here on the left-hand side, I just recall you the main construction we've seen so far. Now on the right-hand side, we will see an example. So suppose that we have our elliptic curve that has a minimal SNC model such that the spatial fiber is a loop of rational curves. Then this is the picture that we have. This is our spatial fiber that is a loop of rational curve. The dual complex will be given by edges and vertices such that this is homeomorphic to an S1. We know that we can embed these inside the Berkovich space. It means that inside the Berkovich space, we have an S1. Now, we want to study all other models dominating this given one, for instance. And there are basically two operations that we can do. There are just blow-ups. So we can blow up a smooth point in the spatial fiber, or we could blow up a node. So we already seen, I mean, this is just, again, an application of Stepanov, that the dual complex will change in this way. So we will have new exceptional curves and we could have new edges or just subdivision of given edges. And this is also reflected in the Berkovich space. So we'll get a bigger skeletons inside EAN. So now here I just consider two blowups, but indeed we could consider a combination of these two types of blowups many times. So we could just, so this will be reflected in the Berkovich space by having new subdivision and new edgings from starting from this S1. And if we keep doing this process, so if we really do like, we want to realize this inverse limit of all the SNC skeletons, then the picture that we will get in the end is the following. So we will get that the Berkovich space associated to the elliptic curve E is given by an S1. And then if we parameterize this S1 as an interval 0, 1, at all the rational point, we will have like an infinite tree that will start at the point and, I mean, and and grows from there. And now it's really, you can visualize this retraction. So for any given model, the retraction is just retracting all the leaves that are not in the model back to the points, I mean, back to the points where the leaf is starting. So for instance, the retraction to the S1 will take all these branches and will just retract the whole branch back to the point, back to the branching point in the S1. So here you really see how they all have the same homotopy type, how the retraction can be constructed. And you can also see as a sort of flow, you can also see the strong deformation retraction back to the S1. Okay, so far we've seen Berkowitz spaces associated to SNC model, because we've seen for SNC varieties, we have the dual complex. But in the birational approach that I described, I've seen that indeed, we don't have to stick to SNC models. We can be more general. We can, for instance, work with DLT models or even minimal DLT models. And in the context of dual complex, this was giving us a well-defined homomorphism type. So we can expect that the same will also hold in the skeleton. So if instead of working with an SNC model, we work with a DLT model, then we will have a canonical skeleton associated. So this has been formalized, and this is the notion of an essential skeleton. So we are same setting, smooth projective variety. We assume that we have a good minimal DLT model for our variety. Then we've seen that the dual complex is a well-defined homomorphism type. And so, that indeed just depend on the variety X, because it doesn't matter which particular good minimal DLT model we choose, they all have the same dual complex. Then it's embedded in the Berkowitz space will also be minimal and canonical with respect to X. And so we'll call it an essential skeleton. Let me just make one quick remark. So there is also another way to realize this essential skeleton that is not using minimal DLT model. So indeed, there is an alternative definition that just that use the notion of essential faces. So we can suppose that instead of really constructing the minimal DLT model, we take any SNC model. We take the skeleton associated, and then there is a well-defined notion of being an essential face inside the skeleton. So what it has been proved by Nikkei and Xu is that these two definitions are indeed equivalent. So that just selecting the faces that are essential will give us a rise to a subcomplex inside any skeleton. But this subcomplex will indeed coincide with the dual complex that comes from a good minimal DLT model. So this gives us two ways to think and study this essential skeleton. In one case, we realize the minimality property by first looking at the minimal model and then taking the dual complex. In the other context, we do not work with minimal models. We just work with any models, but we realize the minimality just by finding a way to detect which faces are indeed minimal and will coincide with the dual complex of a minimal model. So depending on the context, it can be convenient to work with one description or the other. And let me also mention that, I mean, this idea of essential faces was indeed inspired by Concevich and Seubelmann in their non-Archimedean approach to mirror symmetry, and was later developed in details by Mustat and Nikkei. But today, let me mention why we will focus on the birational approach, meaning the description of the essential skeleton as the dual complex of a good minimal DLT model. So there are basically two reasons. So the first one is that since we realize this essential skeleton as coming from a good minimal DLT model, we again have a Berkowitz retraction. So we again have a map from XAN back to the essential skeleton. So even if the essential skeleton does not depend on the particular good minimal DLT model we choose, The retraction will depend. We've seen, I mean, this is constructed the same way of the retraction that I described for the in the SNC case. It really depends on the model. So this means that we have retraction to the essential skeleton, but these are non-canonical in the sense that it really depends on the model we choose. And then the second advantage is in taking this birational description is that we can prove that not only the Berkovich space associated to an SNC degeneration, but even the essential skeleton has the same homotopy type of the Berkovich space. And the way it can be proved is by a combination of two results. So first, using the Berkovich retraction, we can retract to a model that is SNC. And so we have strong deformation retraction by the result of Berkovich in Toulier. And then, thanks to the birational description of what happens when we run an MMP, but so the result of De Ferney, Collard, and Xu, we know that we can go from the dual complex of an SNC pair to the essential skeleton just by a composition of collapses. So this gives us that then we have the two objects, the Berkovich space and the essential skeleton, have the same homotopy type. Okay, but I mean, it would not be possible right now to prove this result without describing this essential skeleton as the dual complex of a minimal model. So this is why the birational characterization for this type of result is indeed very convenient. So let me, so here we've seen also the non-Archimedean version of this canonical dual complex that now it's phrased as an essential skeleton. And with respect to this retraction from the Berkovich space to the essential skeleton, there is one property, one more property that I would like to mention that indeed will show us how this notion of essential skeleton and retraction is related to the work in mirror symmetry, in particular to the non-Archimedean mirror symmetry approach. So, but let's go slowly and let's see, for instance, what Nikes and Xu and Yu have proved about this retraction. So they consider the case of a maximally degenerate Calabi-Yau. So we already see maximally degenerate Calabi-Yau when I mentioned the work of Collard, Lazar, Sakai, and Voisin. But here, so let me just repeat one more time. So we work with Calabi-Yau, meaning that we work with Kx trivial. So I'm not assuming strict Calabi-Yau. And in particular, we consider a maximally degenerate. So meaning that the skeleton and the variety X have the same dimension that is N. Now in this context, if we consider a good minimal DLT model, so the one we worked so far, then we have our retraction from the Berkovich space to the essential skeleton. And what Nikes and Xu and Yu prove is that this map is indeed an affine torus vibration, away from a locus of codimension two in the base. So what does it mean to be an affine torus vibration? It means the following. So that away from some locus of codimension two in the base, this map that is the one we consider, the retraction of rho curl X, is locally isomorphic to a map that is called a tropicalization map. So let me describe it for you. So here we have a Berkovich space. It is the Berkovich space associated to a torus. So G and M is the multiplicative torus of dimension M, and we take the analytification. Then this Berkovich space is a tropicalization map to the space R to the N. So this, this tropicalization can be described very concretely. So if I take a valuation, I want to produce a point in Rn. So I will fix, for instance, Z1, Zn coordinate of my torus. And then this valuation will be sent to Vz1, Vzn. These are indeed points. These are real value. So this gives rise to a point in Rn. So what this result in saying is that when we work with maximally degenerate Calabi-Yau, then this retraction to the essential skeleton are modeled locally and away from some locus of codimension bigger than two, they are modeled from tropicalization map. So basically from analytification of a torus to a space, to an open in Rn. So the reason why this result is particularly interesting is that it's a sort of an analog of a conjecture that maybe you heard of. It's the Strominger-Yao-Zaslow conjecture. So this is stated in a more like complex analytic setting. So we're working with indeed a smooth maximally degenerate family of Calabi-Yau. And now we're not working, I mean, we're working, as I say, in the complex case. So now we're really looking at a punctured disk at the origin. What this conjecture predicts is the following. Then a general fiber XT will admit a vibration from XT to B such that the base is a topological manifold, and such that the fiber are special Lagrangian tori of real dimension n, again, away from a locus of codimension two in the base. So let me give you a picture. So this is saying that if we see this family in a more like a complex analytic setting, but it's still a family of maximally degenerate family of Calabi-Yau, then a general fiber will admit a fibration such that almost everywhere our fiber are tori. And what is very specific of the conjecture is that we not only want like topologically tori, we also want this condition of being special Lagrangian. And this is the art part of the conjecture. But I mean, this does not happen everywhere. We will have, for instance, some locus of lower or bigger codimension, where, for instance, we don't have like a tori. I mean, here a picture like a pinched tori. So we can have some singular fiber. So if you've seen these two, this result by Nikes and Xu and Yu, and the conjecture, the S with Z conjecture, are sort of analog of each other. I mean, one is in the setting of complex geometry, the other is in the setting of non-Archimedean geometry, but both are sort of predicting the existence of vibrations that are modeled from the identification of a torus, in this other case, as having fibers, the fibers are tori. So, I mean, the reason why I'm putting these two conjectures one next to the other is that they are, I mean, both related to mirror symmetry. So let me try to just give you a hint of this relation. So maximally degenerate family of Calabi-Yau, this is precisely the setting of mirror symmetry. Because in a nutshell, mirror symmetry is trying to study, I mean, it starts from an observation of a phenomenon of duality between Calabi-Yaus. And it predicts that Calabi-Yaus should come in pairs, meaning that if I have a Calabi-Yau XT, for instance, coming from a fiber of the SYZ, then there should exist another Calabi-Yau XT check, and these two should be related. So their geometry should be related, or maybe geometric invariants of the two should be related. So, I mean, it's still like, the two big questions in mirror symmetry are, give a precise definition of what does it mean to be mirror, and then also give techniques to construct the mirror once one Calabi-Yau, for instance, is given. So then the SYZ conjecture can be seen as a geometric explanation for mirror symmetry. So it tried to answer the first question. So it tried to say that the two varieties are indeed mirror to each other if they both admit an SYZ fibration on a common base, such that if one is given, as it was in the case of the prediction of the SYZ, there exists such a fibration, then the mirror variety can be constructed using this fibration. So, I mean, this conjecture that, I mean, if you've seen the statement, there is just one family involved, there is no like mirror Calabi-Yau, is indeed a geometric explanation, because it really tried to give a way to define what does it mean to be mirror partners and also to construct the mirror. But then, I mean, in light of this observation, we can see this retraction from the Berkovich space to the essential skeleton as a non-Archimedean SOHZ vibration, because indeed this is a conjecture, but if we move to the Berkovich identification, for instance, of our Calabi-Yau, then by using this minimal DLT model, we are able to construct this map. And this map, I mean, have property that are sort of analog of the property of the SOHZ, in the sense that they are locally isomorphic to a tropicalization map. And then let me just conclude by mentioning, I mean, so far it seems that these are just two words that do not interact. I mean, one is in the classical complex topology, and the other is in the non-Archimedean topology. What was like a crucial and interesting insight by Konsevich and Soberman is that indeed the base of the SOHZ vibration is expected to be related to a degeneration of the variety XT, in the sense that we expect the base B to be indeed the dual complex of a degeneration of the Calabi-Yau variety. So here you really see that the two picture sort of connects and interact, in the sense that now, I mean, for instance, we can study this conjectural base also from a non-Archimedean perspective by describing B first as a dual complex and then as an essential skeleton. So here you really see like the dual complex is a sort of bridge between three different worlds. The birational geometry, since we use birational techniques, for instance, to define a well-defined homomorphism type. We see now then the dual complex as an essential skeleton. So this bridges in the work of non-Archimedean geometry. And then we see a third world appearing, that is the world of mirror symmetry and this like geometric approach to mirror symmetry using non-Archimedean geometry. So, I mean, I think I will stop here. I thank you all for your attention, and I hope you will join the discussion in the upcoming weeks and also the common coffee break that we will have at the end, so that we can keep discussing and talks about this notion and this result that I try to mention, present to you today. So thank you very much again for your attention.